At this point, the character of our discussion of computability is going to change significantly. We've established the key properties of Turing machines, that they can do anything we mean by computation, and that we can pass a description of a Turing machine to a Turing machine as input for it to simulate. With those points established, we won't need to talk about the specifics of Turing machines much anymore. There will be little about tapes or states, transitions or head positions. Instead, we'll think about computation at a very high level, trusting that if we really had to, we could write out the Turing machine to do it. If we need to write out code, we'll do so mostly in pseudocode or with pictures. What is there left to talk about? Well, remember from the very first lesson that we argued that not all functions are computable, or as we later said, not all languages can be decided by Turing machines. We're now in a good position to talk about some of these undecidable languages. We had to wait until we established the universality of Turing machines, because these languages are going to consist of strings that encode Turing machines. The rest of the lesson will review the definitions of recognizability and decidability, and then we'll talk about the positive side of the story, the languages about Turing machines that we can decide or recognize. As we'll see later, there are plenty that we can't.